My name is Aparna Bamzai, and I'm the University Assistant Director of the South Central Climate Science Center. Today, I'll be going over some basic economic concepts. Fundamentally, economics is the study of how people produce, distribute, trade, and consume commodities such as goods, services, or policies. In some cases, people act as individuals, carrying out economic actions from one person to another. In other cases, the people who take action, or actors, are groups of people, like a household, a business, or a federal agency. For example, state actors may negotiate the transfer of winter wheat between Oklahoma and Mexico. Modern economics is typically divided into two fields, microeconomics and macroeconomics. Microeconomics is the study of how individual actors make decisions about the allocation of their resources. These individual actors could be people or households or even corporations. Like in other disciplines, economists make assumptions about how their system works. The main two assumptions are that actors are rational in their choices and that they will try to maximize the outcome of their transaction. Individual actors make decisions to maximize their outcome based on the value of a commodity. But really, what is something worth? The flippant answer to that question might be that it's worth whatever someone is willing to pay for it. But in reality, that answer is very close to the truth. For goods and services that can be traded in markets such as petroleum products, agricultural goods, or even your smartphone, the price of the commodity is set on an open marketplace of sellers and buyers. Theoretically, sellers and buyers negotiate a price based on the perceived value of a commodity, which includes factors such as how badly you need it and how rare it is. In reality, sellers examine the relationship between the supply of a commodity and the demand for that commodity in what are known as supply and demand curves. For example, natural gas producers would continue to produce natural gas as long as the cost of gas production and distribution, graphed by the supply curve, continues to be less than the price that consumers would be willing to pay, graphed by the demand curve. However, there are many goods and services that cannot be traded in markets, such as clean air and water, stable populations of game birds for hunting, or scenic views of the coast or mountains. In these cases, valuation is more difficult and even sometimes impossible to measure. Economists try to estimate the value of these goods and services in various ways, like a person's willingness to pay for their associated benefits. They then translate these valuations into units of currency for direct comparison with market values of commodities. The second field of economics is macroeconomics, or the study of the economy in aggregate. Often, macroeconomists look at the response of an entire country's economy to actions in different sectors, like agriculture or entertainment, by studying large-scale indicators such as output, unemployment, and inflation. You may have heard the acronym GDP used in the news or other media. Macroeconomists calculate a country's GDP, or gross domestic product, by adding up the market value of all goods and services produced in a given time period. The GDP can then provide a broad indicator of the economic performance of the country and provide a basis for making comparisons from one country to the next, or for that country over time. While microeconomists study how individual actors determine specific market prices, macroeconomists try to understand how the economy as a whole functions. For example, microeconomists examine the changes over time in the price of electricity generated by wind power, while macroeconomists examine whether the portfolio of renewables is growing in the U.S. energy sector. Economics often intersects with the creation of policy when actors want to get the biggest bang for their buck. Cost-benefit analysis provides a way to systematically compare alternative options and determine which is the most sound investment strategy. First, decision makers must generate a list of all the possible options that are available to them. Then, they must try to model all of the costs and benefits that they will incur as a result of each policy over time using a common currency. Finally, they calculate the net present value of each option by aggregating all of the resulting costs and benefits together. While this process may sound fairly straightforward, there are actually many challenges to calculating an accurate net present value. For example, What if I offered you a choice between a policy that gives you $1 today versus $1,000 in a year? Most people would select the $1,000 in a year. But what if I offered you a policy that gave you $1 today versus $10 in a year? The answer becomes murkier since you could invest that $1 now in a way that would give you a greater overall benefit. The process of discounting estimates the present value of something that would be gained in the future. To account for future costs and benefits in a cost-benefit analysis, economists apply a discount rate. However, choosing an appropriate discount rate is extremely important. A high discount rate will reduce future costs and benefits to a very small fraction of present values. This might cause a decision maker to discard a policy option that has a low immediate cost but a high future payoff. In contrast, a lower discount rate keeps the value of future costs and benefits close to current values. This could cause a decision maker to think that a policy option with a high immediate payoff has the same value as one with a high payoff far in the future. Another complication to calculating the net present value of a policy option is that there are benefits that you don't receive from discarded alternatives when you select a given course of action. This is called the opportunity cost. For example, people give up wages when they go to college full-time instead of working full-time. However, the delayed benefit that students rely on is that they can earn a higher salary and accumulate more wealth over their career with a college degree in hand. Students make a risk-based calculation that finishing their degree holds the greatest net present value to them in comparison to other life choices, knowing that the opportunity cost is a loss of wages in the short term. If the end outcome of all opportunities could be reliably determined, then all decisions would be easy. Instead, economists and policymakers must accumulate as much information as possible and hope that they are able to choose the outcome with the greatest benefit for all. This challenge is particularly difficult in climate policymaking, where many risks and uncertainties exist and the cost of inaction is high.